So honored to be able to be here and serving the people of South Dakota in District 15.
I feel very honored to be part of this process, and I enjoy the communication I've been able to keep up with them since being here, and hope it continues.
You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Statehouse program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
Representing those who are unable to come to Pierre, why the Democrats are pleased with the new governor but still have some concerns, plus the Sergeant-at-Arms share some history with us on the third day of the 2011 legislative session. Hello and welcome to Statehouse. I'm Stephanie Rissler. We'll begin this program with Democrat Representative Marc Feinstein from Sioux Falls. I caught the lawmaker at his desk, and he shared with me his thoughts on our new governor, as well as some issues he hopes to move through the legislature. And we are here with Representative Marc Feinstein from Sioux Falls, a Democrat. Thanks for being with us this morning, Representative.
Well, thank you.
Now, I know it's only day two of the 2011 session. Yesterday, we heard from the governor, his first state of the state. Tell me your thoughts on what you heard yesterday.
Well, I was real happy to welcome Governor Dugard. It was really a nice chance for Governor Dugard to come and address us, and I was really pleased with a lot of the things that he spoke about.
Was there anything that surprised you from his speech?
Well, no real surprises, but I'm glad to see a couple things that I espouse, is that we need to definitely watch what's going on with the budget. We have to watch what's happening and get rid of any kind of wasteful spending. We may have a different approach and different things of what we want, what we spent, and that comes down to a matter of priorities. If you prioritize things, like in my case, education, and you prioritize that, fund that first, let other things filter around that. The other thing is employees' salaries, to hold them in line again for another year, I think is not really fair to the hardworking folks that work for the state government, and also Medicaid providers. I think we have to realize that if we do the cuts in the wrong places, we're going to lose some wonderful people in those areas. But other things that I was really happy to see, ideas such as the Tribal Relations Committee, and it sounds like Governor Dugard wants to really promote that instead of paying lip service to that. It's been an idea that's been going around since I've been in the legislature, and it's nice to see it finally happening. Another step, I believe, that's very positive is the separation of the veterans from the military affairs and into two separate departments. It's another idea that was percolating the last couple of years, and it's good to see that the governor is taking the lead on that.
Now, you mentioned those things, and those issues have been issues that the Democrats have brought up
Yes.
for the last few years, including the wasteful spending of the state airplane, which
Yes,
you talked about. Did
exactly.
that surprise you that he talked about those things?
No, I think what happens is, and the governor also said something that I firmly believe in, it really doesn't matter who gets the credit for something. We just want the best for the citizens of the state of South Dakota. And I do believe the governor wants the best for the citizens of the state of South Dakota. The members of the Republican Party want the best. The Democrats want the best. Independents also. It's just a matter of maybe how we get there.
Let's move to the issue of the budget. We know that it will take center stage this year, but yet again, lawmakers have to wait a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks into the session before they get the final list of numbers and the governor's proposal. Is that frustrating for you, or is it even a concern?
Well, I've learned now that in my four previous sessions is that that's the way it is. It shouldn't be. We have asked in the past to have the budget out there and ready to vote on midway through session, so we at least have something to go from for the rest of our session. It's possible. It can be done. It is doable. It just hasn't been done that way. Normally, routinely, and I think all members of the legislature feel some of the frustration that the budget and the appropriation bill plops on our desk hours before the vote in the last day of session. And it just doesn't give everybody outside of the Appropriations Committee the opportunity to study it as thoroughly as we really should for the people of South Dakota.
Yeah. I wonder if that will ever be changed, do you think?
I would never say never. I think it's possible to change. I mean, it's like I spoke earlier. Why don't we fund education early in the session and let other things filter around it? As was spoken to me by a more senior legislator years ago, he said, well, we just can't do it. It's not the way it's done. Well, it's not the way it's done since he has been a legislator, but I've been following South Dakota politics, South Dakota legislators. You know, I'm a lifelong South Dakotan, but as an adult in the late 70s, I was watching it, and it was not always done that way. Things changed. The formula that came into effect in 1995 changed how things are done. Things do change. It's just the way some people remember them. So it doesn't have to always be that way.
Any particular bills you're going to be introducing or following, perhaps?
Well, last year I sponsored a bill to reduce the state tax, the 4% tax on food, to zero. It would maintain the 2% tax on food at the tribal level and at the municipal level, but it would get rid of that tax at the state level, and it would be replaced by somewhere like a 0.3 or 0.34%. So it would be a revenue neutral bill. The whole theory is the people that need that help the most would benefit from it. What really, and to me, it's an economic stimulus too, because the folks that this bill would really help, the people that go to the grocery store and where 4%, if they buy $50 worth of food, that's $2. They can't afford that extra $2. They have to put something back, and that could be that gallon of milk for their children. I heard a story about a year ago on that, and it was so gut-wrenching when somebody was so embarrassed they were like $1.30 over. And again, it was sales tax that pulled them over, sales tax on food, that they had to actually put back some items. And they had to put back, in this case, it might have been baby formula, or it was milk. It was a staple for family. And when you hear stories like that, it really hits you. And what would happen? If that person had not had to spend that extra $1.39 on sales tax, they would have bought a product. This is, to me, that's economic stimulus. It's more business for the businesses in South Dakota. Another bill that I'm promoting and plan to be the prime sponsor on with Senator Johnston from the Senate is a veterans foster home bill. There are many veterans that are homeless, and this will help. There are people that want to take care of veterans and actually house them. And I'm not talking on a commercial basis, but on sort of a foster home basis, much like foster children. And this is something that's promoted by the Department of Veteran Affairs, the Federal Department of Veteran Affairs. It is a cost-free proposition to the state of South Dakota. It's paid for by the Veterans Administration, so I mean any of the funds. So Senator Johnston is a veteran. I'm a non-veteran. I work with elderly. I work with seniors in my law practice. I understand the problems, and I think coming at it from a non-veteran point and a veteran's point, we should be able to get a bill like this to flow and have some real meaning for the people that really need it.
Representative Feinstein also shared his thoughts on the educational lawsuit and his hopes that the Supreme Court will rule in favor of the proponents in the case. Many legislators have come and gone over the past 20 years, but in that time, one man has stuck around. Melvin Chandler is the Sergeant at Arms of the South Dakota House of Representatives. And today, the State House crew had a chat with him about his job and some memories of his time spent at the Capitol.
I think this will be my last year.
Really?
I'm 83 years old. I'm getting to a point where things are starting to fall apart. I started down the basement. There was a documents room down there. And I started with a fellow down there. And then this job came up, and I had a friend that was a legislature. And I said, Mike, I'd like to have that job. So I got interviewed and I got the job. I've been here ever since. My duty is to patrol and keep the traffic in the chamber here going. And I announced the governors. The Honorable Governor of the State of South Dakota, Dennis Dugard.
William Janko.
I get to meet a lot of new people, a lot of people I've never would otherwise. All the representatives that's from all over the state, otherwise I'd never meet them. One time we went 24 hours. I come here at 7 o'clock and the next morning at 7:30 I went home.
What was going on? Tell me.
Well, they had a bill and the Senate was arguing about a bill on it. And before we could pass the bill, I had to come back over here. Well, they had it there and it went 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, and I had guys sleeping all over. They're sleeping on the desk, they're sleeping in the hallways and everything. And I had to stay awake because they had some of the guys went to their motels, and in case they voted, I'd have to go get them. But I was lucky. They came back. Most of them all come back here. So back a couple of years ago, Speaker Rex Haig called me up, and there's a if the representatives don't vote on a bill, they cannot stay in the chamber. So he called me, and I went down and I picked this lady, got up and Vermillion, and I escorted her out. That's the only time it's ever happened. You hear things, but you hear and see things, but keep it to yourself. Yeah, I was told that.
That's so, what you'll pass on.
Yeah, it's a pass on, yeah.
Here are some more fun facts, not about the Sergeant of Arms, but about a few state lawmakers. It's time for our bio spot. There are several new faces in this year's legislature. Two of those new faces also hold the title of our youngest females to ever serve in the legislature. I was able to sit down with Senator Angie Buell, a Democrat from Sioux Falls. She shared with me her thoughts on being a fresh new face in Pierre and her own issues she'll be working on this session. And I am joined by Senator Angie Buell. Now, you're a Democrat from Sioux Falls. Welcome to the legislature.
Thank you.
I guess a lot of folks that will be tuning in and watching tonight, your face will be a new face to those across the state. Give us a little bit of background, how you got involved in politics and then wanted to run to be a state lawmaker.
Well, I grew up in Yankton, and my folks own a small business, and they have for a number of years now. And I went to the University of South Dakota and got my degree there and moved to Sioux Falls a few years ago and got interested and started noticing who was currently serving and started feeling like that wasn't being accurate or adequately represented for a lot of different folks in the district. And so I decided to run for the Senate this year.
Okay. Now, was your, you said you went to school at USD.
Yes.
Did you get a political science or any type of government
degree?
No,
my degree is actually in psychology.
Okay. Well, that might come in handy.
That's what I've heard so far.
So tell me about the campaign. I heard that you ran unopposed. Is that right?
In the general, I did have a contested primary. I ran against a Democratic incumbent and knocked on a lot of doors and met a lot of folks and ended up winning 59% of the vote.
Okay, so was that your first campaign experience ever?
That was my first time running myself. I had worked on campaigns before for Senator Tim Johnson and for some other ballot measures along the way, but that was my first time running myself.
Okay, so what did folks tell you as you visited with those that would become your constituents? What kind of things did they share with you?
You know, I heard a wide variety of different things, but the overarching theme was that folks are really concerned about the economy, which I don't think is a surprise to anyone. I talked to a lot of state employees who were concerned about the fact that they hadn't gotten a raise for 2 years, and the way things are looking, that might be a third. A lot of seniors who are concerned about affordable housing, and since my district is 65% renters, that was not a particularly surprise at all either.
Okay, okay. So you heard what was important to them as you discovered on November 2nd that you would be coming to Pierre. What issues were important to you? What did you want to bring to the state capitol?
You know, I really feel like it's my job to represent people who don't get to be here. Mm-hmm. You know, we know that the legislature does not always demographically represent the rest of South Dakota. And so I feel like it's my job to fight for, you know, the elderly and renters and students and all of those interests that need a voice in Pierre.
Can't come. Now, typically we see lawmakers are usually men. There are women here, but the majority of them are men. Mm-hmm. And one thing that we don't see are a lot of younger women. So you really are going to represent kind of a nice, new, fresh face here. Have folks visited with you about that at all? Is it something that's crossed your mind?
It's absolutely something that crossed my mind. It's actually one of the reasons I ran, is because I didn't see young women being represented in Pierre. And so, you know, I've gotten a really positive response so far. I think it's that, you know, the returning folks, the returning legislators to Pierre really see that as a need and see that we need to have as many different voices represented as possible. And so I've been welcomed into their circles, and I'm excited to work with my colleagues on those issues.
Now, I know that there will also be a new leader for the Democrats in the Senate, mm-hmm. Senator Jason Frericks, and you and I have visited briefly about him. He kind of helped you with the selection of those committees.
Yes.
And the reason I bring this question up, because we have a young new female face in you and a young new leader in him. I guess, what does that say to you as you begin the 2011 legislative session?
I think it's really great that we have so many more young faces here. I think that it really speaks to the fact that people see a need for new energy and new ideas. You know, we've seen things happen in the last 8 years that haven't been particularly great for our state. And I think that people recognize that we need some fresh eyes to take a look at the problems that face our state.
Now, a lot of times folks don't run for the legislature simply because they cannot. I mean, really, you have to take 3 months off of work. And mm-hmm. for a young person, particularly somebody that maybe has a family, that's a difficult thing to do. Was this something that you struggled with in your own mind, and how are you going to be able to make this work for you?
It is really challenging to figure out the logistics of serving in Pierre. Like you said, the time off work and the time away from family and making sure you can still pay the rent and the mortgage in the meantime is tricky. You know, I've been able to, you know, save up, and I knew this was coming for a while, and so it's been tricky, but I've made it work with my job, thankfully letting me come here for a little while and serve the people of South Dakota. So it's been tricky, but I think that it'll work out just fine. I am so honored to be able to be here and serving the people of South Dakota in District 15.
Okay.
I am working on a couple of different bills, one potentially related to adoption. Since I'm an adoptee, and it's something that I talked about throughout the campaign, I was asked, or I've been in talks with the adoption folks on that. I'm also working on one that might change whether state employees can use their Family Medical Leave Act for chronic illness. I'm also working on one that deals with discrimination against our seniors and housing and employment. So there's a lot of different things I'm working on, and I'm actually really excited to do all of that. I also think we really need to focus on protecting you know, the departments that are higher on the chopping block than some others, you know, the Department of Education, and making sure that we're investing in K-12 and pre-K as much as we can, and also, you know, preserving our folks on Medicaid, because families really do rely on that, and almost all the families on Medicaid in the state are working and are, you know, hardworking people and really deserve to, you know, be able to rely on what they've been promised.
All right.
So far.
Well, very good. Well, thanks for taking the time to come up here and visit with us. And we'll keep an eye on you. And, of course, your constituents can watch you online at sdpb.org.
Well, thank you for having me.
All right. Thank you. Good luck to you.
Thanks.
Senator Buell shares her district with another new lawmaker. Representative Jenna Hagar is a chiropractic assistant who comes to Pierre as an independent. SDPB's Melissa Sievers visited with her in the House gallery this morning.
Well, thank you for joining us today, Representative Hagar. How is the session going for you initially?
Thank you for inviting me today. The session is going great. We're getting busy and we're working hard and ready to serve the people of South Dakota.
What is it that made you decide to run?
Well, what I really wanted to do was get out in the community in some similar ways that I always have, but really get out there and reach the people who live in my neighborhood, in the district, in the city, in the state, and engage in conversation, find out what they need, and find out what they want.
When is it that you first made that call?
I made the decision earlier this year. It was actually after the Republican-Democrat deadline when I realized that no elected official had ever come and knocked on my door, my family's door. They had never engaged in a conversation with me. And so I started my petition process, and I found out that others felt the same way. And so they're really looking for communication.
You beat out an incumbent. Was that a surprise to you, or, you know, how much... what was the campaign like as you worked to communicate with South Dakotans?
I realized early on that I needed to have an important message to share with people so that win or lose on November 2nd, it was a worthwhile way to spend my time, a worthwhile campaign. So I made sure that it was about a message and not necessarily about me as a candidate or that I would, you know, I'm someone special. I was just really part of the neighborhood, part of the district, and I wanted to get out there and share with others.
You're the only independent representative in the House. What's the significance of that? Does it come with any challenges? Or?
It does in some ways. I'm an independent, and what I really like about that is I can make it about the issues and about the individual needs, and so it's able to give me some more options.
Which party do you caucus with?
I actually am caucusing with the majority party to help get some more legislation passed and do the best service for the state.
Do you have prior legislative experience?
I was actually a page my senior year of high school, and then I came out here and I advocated for the life of the unborn and also end-of-life issues like living will.
Did that prepare you pretty well for your experience now, or... are there surprises?
I think it was the door-to-door, the everyday communications that prepared me. People communicating what they need. A lot of people are saying things like, we haven't had a raise in 2 years. A lot of the state employees haven't had that raise in 2 years. There's even more people saying, we lost our jobs. Our wages have been cut. What are we going to do? So that was the preparation of, because of our downward economy, we're in need.
You have a unique perspective as a young female representative. Does that help your cause, or does that change your perspective or view of some of these issues?
I think it does. It brings a lot of positive energy, not just to me, not just to other young people, but to everyone of all ages. So that is very exciting to see.
What committees are you on?
I'm on Health and Human Services and also Education.
Are those things that you've made your legislative priorities?
I get to zero in and focus on the Health and Human Services and also the education issues and bills, and also the budget is the big the big issue of the year.
Do you have any legislation that you'll be introducing?
I'm working on some, but not any that I've dropped yet.
Okay. You're in a unique position to inspire other young South Dakotans to get involved. Even if it's not to run for the legislature. Have you been advocating to others to get involved in their government process?
Well, I think by running and actually being able to win and having a great message is what has been inspiring to other people. They've come up to me on their own initiative and go, wow, I can't believe you were able to do that. I hope someday I may do the same. And that's really what the House of Representatives is supposed to be. It's supposed to be about the individuals in our community who want to make a change and make a difference.
As a new member, how is the initiation going into this institution?
The whole entire year, people have treated me well and with kindness, and the people in my district have showed support and have shown the desire for something different, and I think that's held true to that.
Is there anything that you'd like to share with your voters back in Sioux Falls?
I feel very honored to be part of this process, and I enjoy the communication I've been able to keep up with them since being here, and hope it continues.
And that will conclude this edition of State House. Be sure to join us tomorrow as we bring you edited highlights of the end of the week press briefings. Now, if you would like to watch those press briefings unedited, we do air them live on SDPB Channel 2. That begins at 9:30 a.m. Central Time. And don't forget to friend us on Facebook or follow all of our action on Twitter. Now, for all of us with South Dakota Public Broadcasting, thank you for watching.
Statehouse program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.